Hello there. I'm Jock. Please join me, and we can examine the scarier side of our village's historic past, which dates back as far as 400 AD. Since then, there have been many strange events and legends, some quite sad, some very bloody. From William Wallace, the plague, early surgery, and body snatching, through two world wars and ghostly spine-tingling apparitions. Whether you believe in ghosts or not, we have a story for everybody. So, come with me as we delve back into Torphichen's murky and bloody past. Up the high brae on your right, you can see Rockcliffe Cottage, which was also known as the Old Infirmary. With the outbreak of war in 1914, most of the male villagers volunteered to fight for king and country, many of whom never came back from the trenches. In 1915, Bangour Village Hospital, only 4 miles away from Torphichen, was taken over by the War Office as a military hospital. Its patients were transferred to asylums around the country. The number of staff and beds increased substantially to cater for the influx of wounded soldiers who began to arrive in June of that year. By 1918, the hospital had reached a capacity of 3,000 patients, crammed into wards, huts, and specially erected marquees. Due to overcrowding at Bangour Military Hospital, local parishioners took it upon themselves to set up small infirmaries for injured and shell-shocked soldiers. Some of these were billeted in Torphichen at the infirmary house. Many of the soldiers died from their wounds, and there have been reports of eerie sightings and strange sounds in and around the old infirmary house. General James Wolfe didn't have the best of reputations in Scotland for his part in suppressing the Jacobite cause. Wolfe participated in the Battle of Falkirk and the Battle of Culloden in 1746, where he famously refused to shoot a wounded Highlander when ordered by Butcher Cumberland, saying that he'd rather resign his post than sacrifice his honour. However, the gesture did not work, and the man was shot by Cumberland himself. Wolfe's experience on the battlefield led him to commanding the British forces in the campaign with the French and native Canadians in the Battle of Quebec in 1759. Most of Wolfe's forces were made up of men from the Highland Fusiliers, the Fraser Highlanders, and the Royal Scots. This is where Wolfe's link with Torphichen comes from. Wolfe's pipe major, Archibald MacGregor, lived in a cottage in the now school grounds. During the Battle of Plains of Arnhem, Wolfe's company became separated from the main battlefield. They were quickly surrounded by native Canadians who shot into the company of soldiers. One by one, the British troops fell. As they fell, they were scalped. Many were still alive when this was done. General Wolfe was shot 3 times by musket fire and fell. His loyal piper, MacGregor, attended to his dying commander. Wolfe whispered to MacGregor and said with his dying breath, "Play me a lament." As MacGregor played, the general passed on. MacGregor was the last man standing from the company of soldiers. He fought valiantly until the end. The cottage was converted into a school dining hall in the 1900s and was demolished in the late 1960s. When it was being demolished, workmen found MacGregor's pipes and his blood-stained uniform in the cellar. From that day, there have been reports of a shadowy Highland figure playing pibroch in the school grounds. Now, you make up your own minds. Is that the spirit of MacGregor wandering the schoolyard? The Knights Hospitaller, established during the Crusades, were invited to Scotland in 1132 by David I. After the suppression of the Knights Templar in 1312, lands were transferred to the Knights Hospitaller. Torphichen was one of the major hospitaller sites in Britain, second to the Priory of Clerkenwell in London. After the Battle of Falkirk in 1298, Edward Longshanks was brought to the preceptory to receive treatment for his injuries caused when his horse stamped on him. During the wars of Scottish independence, the Hospitallers fought on the side of the English and withdrew after the Scots' victory at Bannockburn, returning during the rule of Robert the Bruce. The preceptor, Sir William, served as Lord High Treasurer of Scotland for James III and James IV, with the title of Lord St. John of Torphichen. It is commonly held that he died at the Battle of Flodden in 1513. The last preceptor, Sir James Sandilands, was the second son of James Sandilands, Baron of Calder. Sir James's father and elder brother both backed the Lords of the Congregation and were friends of John Knox. In February 1564, Sir James surrendered preceptory lands to the Crown, his relative Mary Queen of Scots, where she gave the lands back to him for a payment of 10,000 crowns, with the secular title of Lord Torphichen, which still exists. The order ceased to continue to operate in the village after this period, only to return again in 1947. During the order's procession from St. John's Hall, top of the village, to the preceptory, a photograph was taken to show the grand scale of events. As the photographer was going through his photographs, he came across one photograph that sent shivers up his spine. In the window of one of the houses, there was a figure of a young girl standing, looking out of the window. When the photographer approached the family with the copy, the family didn't have a young child in the house and couldn't explain how there could be someone in their home. To this day, it still remains a mystery, and one where, if you're lucky, you may just see the face of a young girl looking out at you from the window. The bubonic plague was one of the most devastating pandemics in human history, resulting in the deaths of an estimated 200 million people, peaking in Europe in the year 1353. In the early 1330s, an outbreak of the deadly plague first occurred in China. The Black Death, as it was more commonly known, mainly affected rodents. The disease was transmitted to livestock and then eventually to humans. The symptoms of the Black Plague were initially a fever and very painful swelling of the lymph glands that grew to the size of an apple. Then spots would appear on the skin. First, they would be red, eventually turning black. In many cases, the tips of the fingers would also turn black and fall off. This was followed by a fever, which meant that the end was only a few hours away. Being one of the biggest trading nations in the world, China was a melting pot of activity and had a diverse mix of people condensed into many small trading areas. It was only a matter of time before the plague was carried along the trading routes into Europe. In 1346, the Black Death had reached the Italian ports. By the following year, it had reached Scotland, killing over 300,000 inhabitants, some of which, no doubt, were poor souls of Torphichen. Edward Longshanks had undermined King John Baliol's authority in Scotland. He demanded Baliol paid homage towards England and claimed he had legal authority over the Scottish king. He also claimed Scottish military support in his war against France. Longshanks treated Scotland as a feudal state and repeatedly humiliated the new king. The Scottish noblemen tired of their king. State affairs were taken out of the hands by the leading men of the kingdom, who appointed a council of 12. At Stirling, in July 1295, these men were a group of advisers to King John. They went on to form a treaty of mutual assistance with France, which is known as the Auld Alliance. In 1295, Longshanks became aware of the secret Franco-Scottish negotiations. In early October, he began to strengthen his northern defences against a possible invasion from the Scots. Longshanks invaded Scotland, taking Berwick and defeating the Scots at the Battle of Dunbar in April 1296. King John abdicated the Scots crown in July 1296. He was imprisoned in the Tower of London. By the winter of 1297, Scotland had a new hero, William Wallace. Flushed with success after the stunning victory at Stirling Bridge, he led raids over the border. His small army ransacked churches, monasteries, castles, taking everything of value. At Hexham Monastery, Wallace found three monks hiding in the chapel. The rest of the monks had taken everything of value to Carlisle Castle. On hearing this, Wallace crossed the north of England. His small, highly trained Scots army laid siege to the castle, but the fortifications proved too strong for the ill-equipped Scots. Cutting their losses, Wallace moved his army north, back onto home soil. There was a small skirmish at Annan, where the Scots completely overran an English garrison. Wallace's forces gathered more and more men, as the story of the murder of English Sheriff of Lanark by Wallace became known. Wallace's army camped in a forest near Carluk. It was here that Scottish noblemen conferred on Wallace the title of Guardian of Scotland. Wallace accepted on one condition, that all Scotland's noblemen would meet at a Scottish parliament in the preceptory of Torphichen. There have been numerous reports of sightings over the last 800 years, of apparitions, ghostly figures, and the noise of claymores crashing coming from the grounds. Local nuns were drafted in to help the hospitallers after the Battle of Falkirk. The sister who was treating Edward Longshanks laughed out loud when she heard it was Longshanks' horse that had broken his ribs and not, as he was boasting, that it had happened on the battlefield. Longshanks, disgusted, had her tongue cut out so she would never laugh again. Legend has it, if you make eye contact with the ghost of the Grey Lady, she will rip your tongue out. And that, ladies and gentlemen, is why I would not advise a visit on a dark night to the preceptory. Strange lights that move around the grounds are said to be the spirit of the Grey Lady. By the end of the 17th century, Surgeons' Hall had been built in Edinburgh, and by 1729, the scientific teaching of surgical practices was being established. However, we were still a long way from the standards we are used to today. One surgeon described walking to the operating room as like going to a hanging. Another feels he is preparing the patient for death. With no safe method of pain relief, belts and physical restraints were used to hold down the patient. As a coping mechanism, early surgeons would become emotionally detached from the horror, pain, and suffering before them. But with no anaesthetic, and often conscious throughout, well, God help the patient, and let's hope they survive. It was not until the 1840s, with the advent of early anaesthetics, that some relief was had. However, these early methods were haphazard, unreliable, and dangerous. Just a few miles from Torphichen in Bathgate in 1811, James Young Simpson was born, the seventh son of farmers and bakers Mary and David. His education started at age four, and he soon impressed all with his intelligence and memory. This would lead him to Edinburgh University at 14 years. From the arts into medical studies, James went on to pass his exams at the Royal College of Surgeons, and went into practice with midwifery at the forefront. James would go on to become a founder of modern obstetrics and professor of midwifery. But it was his experimentation with the developing use of anaesthetics that was about to make profound change around the world. He had perfected the application of chloroform as an anaesthetic and insisted it could be used to alleviate pain in surgery and everyday childbirth. In 1853, Queen Victoria gave birth to her eighth child with the use of chloroform, and with this, any opposing voices were silenced. In 1870, James Young Simpson died. A year before, he had been promoting the rights of women to enter the medical field. A day of mourning was declared for this intelligent, caring, sensitive man, and on that day, 2,000 followed his hearse, and 30,000 more lined the streets. A wonderful epitaph for this local farmer's boy who did so much to rid the world of pain and suffering. You can still visit Surgeons Hall in Edinburgh to this day, and perhaps pay homage to the brave early pioneers of modern medicine. If you were to wander through the graveyard in Old Torphichen, you might just see a few clues to a grim new profession that emerged in the 19th century, the body snatcher. A growing number of surgeons and doctors, keen to improve their medical knowledge, needed corpses on which they could conduct dissections. Interestingly, these grisly dissections would often be performed in theatres where members of the public could pay to watch the macabre performance. Bodies were difficult to come by, and as it was only legal to perform a dissection on the corpse of a recently executed criminal, body snatchers or resurrection men made money by digging up fresh corpses and selling them to medical schools and hospitals, who asked very little questions. Now, it is not known if the body snatchers came to Old Torphichen graveyard, but so worried were the parishioners that they built a stone watchman's house in 1825. People were afraid of being torn from their graves, so the rich would pay for metal coffins or wooden caskets bound in metal bands called mort safes. Bodies of the poor were more likely to end up on the surgeon's slab. Many of the sandstone graves are now crumbling away, but there are still many interesting gravestones here to see. But I would advise you, these should be viewed in daylight hours, when there is less chance of you bumping into the grey lady and finishing your day on a surgeon's slab.